So welcome everybody for this lecture 28, the last lecture, where we are going to discuss about the strategies for transition towards value-based life and profession. Essentially, what we mean is the human society. So transition towards human society. So how do we go about? What will be the process? Can we at least get some, you know, kind of feel of, you know, how we can go about doing it? If not the exact detail, but some feel of how, you know, one can go about it. So this is what we want to discuss in this session. In fact, we were talking about in the last but one session, you know, that ultimately we have to move towards this human society, towards this undivided society and universal human order. Starting from family and going right up to the world family. So this is what we aim at. And if you remember the very first session, okay, we said, you know, what we are going to talk about is basically about the holistic development and the role of education in that process. Right. So the first lecture was about holistic development and role of education. This last lecture is now trying to sum up that, you know, and in the light of what we have discussed in the, you know, 26 lectures in between. Now we will be able to talk about this holistic development, and we will be able to see what is the role of education in that process and what we can do, you know, about it, how we can go about in the process of education to ensure this transformation to a human society, transformation to, you know, this holistic development. So if you recall, we said that the basic human aspiration is for continuity of happiness and prosperity for one, for many, and for all. And we said that this can be ensured by way of having right understanding, right feeling, and necessary physical facility. And we also said that for this, what we need to do basically is to transform from animal consciousness to human consciousness at the individual level. So that is where we can begin. But ultimately, we have to transform from inhuman society to human society. So these two transformations are, you know, basically required. Number one, the transformation at the individual level from animal consciousness to human consciousness. And second, transformation from inhuman society to human society. So this was something which we discussed in the very first session. And this is what now we would like to discuss in this last session, that how this transformation, this transition from inhuman consciousness to human consciousness can take place. How this transformation from inhuman society to human society can take place. And if you remember what we had said right there, that this education is going to play the most significant role in this process of transformation. Education is going to play the most important role in this transformation, in this transition from animal consciousness to human consciousness and inhuman society to human society. And we had defined this route that human education would lead to human consciousness in every child. With human consciousness, we'll have this clarity about the human values that we have been discussing in this module. With clarity about the human values, we'll have this human conduct. And when we have people, you know, living with human consciousness, with human values and human conduct, we will be able to understand, you know, how this human society would look like. So we'll be able to work for this human society. So these three things, you know, we said right in the beginning, that through human education, we can ensure human values. Through human values, we can ensure human conduct. And with human conduct, we can ensure a human society, a human constitution and human society. Am I audible, Rajulji? Am I audible?
Yes, Ganesh.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Changing the slides, so a little bit of this one was there. Interruption was there, yeah. But you are audible, Ganesh. Please go ahead. I've shifted the slides to the new version.
Yeah, but that next one, that human education thing was not there in this.
Yeah, 1 second. Yes.
So this is what we described in the very first session, okay. And this is what we are going to describe in this last session, you know, in more detail. So let us look at that, you know, how do we go about this? So in a sense, we are saying this transformation at the individual level is required, the transformation at the societal level is required, and this can be facilitated through education, through human education. And we had also said that if we want to really work out these details, you know, of how do we go about, you know, and look at the broad steps, right? We had defined these three steps. Number one, we said we have to prepare the people, you know, who has this right understanding and right feeling and right thought, or who are living with human consciousness to begin with, right? So we have to prepare the parents, the policymakers, teachers, the educators, right? Who are now willing to understand this transformation themselves. They are working for it, and they are willing to provide this to their children. So they are willing to work for human education. So that is the first step. Steps towards human society. If you see, the first step is the people's education program for parents, for teachers, for policymakers. That is how what we are doing. So if you look at this morning session, this is an effort to, you know, work with people who have concern for, you know, their self-development and who have concern for the development of the system of education, which is human. Once we have such people, then we can work for the education, right? Education for children. And when we work for this education for children, and what we have been mentioning many times, that we have to work to make sure that this becomes the part of the mainstream education. First, it becomes the part of mainstream education, and then it becomes the basis of mainstream education. So when we are saying value education, what we mean is that it has to become the part of this mainstream education. And when we are saying value-based education, what we are saying is that it has to become the basis of the mainstream education. So this is the second step. And third step is that when both these things are done, and we have people with, you know, right understanding, you know, with understanding of human values, you know, and with human conduct, they can become the source of human society. They can become the source of human society. So we can work for the human society. We can work for the undivided society and universal human order, starting from family to world family. So this is broadly the steps. When we were talking about harmony in society, we talked about it in know, detail, you know, how this society would look like, this harmonious society would look like. It, what is going to be the comprehensive human goal, and how this human goal can be fulfilled through the different human systems. So broadly, this is what we have to do. We have to start with preparing people who have concern for education, who are willing to work on themselves, transform themselves, and with that transformation, work for education, right? For ensuring this transformation in the education, right? Make it human. Then we have to work in the education, mainstream education, to ensure that this becomes the part of the mainstream education, and that then it becomes the basis of the mainstream education. And if we are able to do it, then we are in a position to work for a society which is human, which is humane, a society which is working for this relationship and the harmony in the society, working for an undivided society and universal human order. So if you look at the core message of what we have been saying, we are saying that to be able to fulfill the basic human aspiration, that is happiness and prosperity and their continuity, it is essential to gain the right understanding, the understanding about oneself, understanding about the rest of nature and existence, and understanding how this continuous happiness and prosperity can be ensured through this understanding. Understanding of harmony and living in harmony. So this is the, you know, beginning of the whole exercise. And this involves the realization that there is an innate harmony at all levels of existence. In fact, the whole existence is in the form of coexistence. So not that we have to, you know, construct nature and existence which is in harmony, but we have a nature, we have an existence which is already in the form of coexistence. Right? So we only have to understand it, not construct it. So this nature, this existence is already in the form of coexistence in harmony. And therefore, it is essential purpose of human being to understand this harmony, this coexistence. And we have been calling this by name of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So we have to understand that this is there. This is the way the existence is. Existence is in the form of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. And we have to learn to live, you know, in accordance with it. And if we learn to live it in accordance with it, and we understand this, you know, coexistence, harmony, and relationship, we have the feeling of this coexistence, harmony, and relationship, and we are living with this coexistence, harmony, and relationship, then we are fulfilled. We have this fulfillment in us. So we are in harmony within, and we are in a state of happiness within, in continuity. So this is how human being can be fulfilled. Right? So if we do this, if we understand the harmony and live in harmony at all levels of our existence, then it leads to individual transformation from animal consciousness to human consciousness. And it also leads to societal transformation from inhuman society to human society. So this is the core message. This is what we have been talking about, right, all through. So with this core message, now we can, you know, see some of the steps for transition. And as we have been saying, every time we are talking about this, you know, steps, talking about the process, to go through the process of transition or change, we have been saying that these are tentative, you know, descriptions, or one of the possible descriptions about how you know we can go ensuring this kind of process of development, that process of change. So even these steps that we are mentioning here is, you know, one way of kind of describing the process of change, the process of transition, the process of transformation. Right? But it is important to understand these steps, because when we understand these steps, we can work on it, on them. And through those steps, it is possible for us to go, you know, ensure this transformation, transformation from, you know, human consciousness and inhuman consciousness to human consciousness, and transformation from inhuman society to human society. So let's look at these steps, you know, and we have to really keep it ourselves open that, you know, these are not the only steps that we can, or this is not the only way to talk about these steps. Okay, this is one possible way in which we can understand this process of change, process of transition, process of transformation. But there can be many other ways, and there can be, you know, many other steps that can be defined, you know, depending upon the, you know, time, the space, the, you know, conditions at that point of time. So this is one such possibility that we are talking about. So we can describe this in, you know, different steps. And here, if you see, we have described it in terms of five steps, step one to step five. And then we'll continue. And ultimately, we have placed this step N. Right? So that means there'll be many steps in between. But ultimately, what we have to do is what is mentioned in step 10, step N. So step one is very simple, that we have been talking about all through. Step one is to ensure this individual transformation. So we have to work out these steps for individual transformation, because that, from there we have to begin. And this is important to note, you know, most of the time what Meenuji was talking, you know, in the beginning, that, you know, these people from corporate, okay, they will see, feel that, you know, what we are talking about is in, is contrary to their interest, and therefore they may not accept it, or they may oppose it. Now there we are trying to start, you know, transforming with, you know, start with transforming the other. So when we start with transforming the other, we may have opposition. But when we start with transforming ourselves, there is no opposition. And that is what we are, you know, talking about. Huh? That we can always begin with transforming ourselves. So first step is individual transformation. Individual transformation. Once we are able to ensure this individual transformation, or when we are working for this individual transformation, we can work for step two, that is creating mass awareness towards holistic development and human education. So if you look at what we are doing, you know, most of us, somebody's mic is open, so voice is coming. Yeah. So what we were saying is that once we have this individual transformation, or once we are working for this individual transformation, then we can work for creating an awareness, right? Awareness in the people about this holistic development and, you know, human education. And this is what most of us are doing. So most of us who are there in this session, okay, are essentially trying to do this. They are trying to work for their individual transformation from animal consciousness to human consciousness. And they are also working to make other people aware, particularly these people who are, you know, related to education, you know, the parents, the teachers, the policymakers. So most of us here are working on step one and step two. Right? Now, once there is, you know, this individual transformation and there is this awareness, you know, towards this need for holistic development and need for human education, then step three, we can move towards human education, towards humanizing the mainstream education. And this is what we are trying to do, you know, through the team, through AICT, through different universities and colleges. We are trying to move towards the human education, towards human education. And as I was just mentioning, that while working for it, you know, while moving towards human education in these universities, in college, in AICT, we have these three sub-steps. The first sub-step is that we are working for introducing this value education in the mainstream education. So make it a part of the mainstream education. And then we are saying that that's not enough. We start with this, but then the whole education has to be based on understanding of this human education, understanding of the human values. So it has to be value-based education. And ultimately we are saying that the whole, you know, the college, the university, the institution has to be a living model of the value-based living. So these are the steps that, you know, we have been talking about. So step three, we are saying moving towards human education, that is humanizing the mainstream education through value education and value-based education. Step four, we are saying that we have to make these institutions, the educational institution, as living model of holistic development, living model of human society. So step four, we are saying developing models for human living in educational institution. Right. So many of us are working from step one to step five, step four. Right. So we are in some educational institution, or we are there as parents who have concern for human education. So we are working with step one in ourselves. We are working with other people, people who are related to education particularly, you know, through step two. And then we are trying to work on step three, and wherever it is possible, work on step four. So this is what we are doing, right? Most of us who are, you know, present in this session, this is what we are doing, moving from step one to step four. Once these institutions become the living model of human society, right, of holistic living, then we can work with the community around, right? We can work for developing the models for human society. And this is what we were talking about in the last session, if you remember, right? So we have to work out these models, you know, for human society, right? Work out at least, you know, the holistic living, living at the community level, community around us. And we said that, you know, if you look at the Indian villages, even now, they have a fairly good potential to become a living model of holistic living, right, of human society. And we had, you know, talked about some description about a society, you know, a community which is living together with something there, something around 1,000 people with 100-150 families, right? Then can we work out a human system there which can work for fulfillment of human goal through proper education system, through proper health system, through proper production system, right? And all that. So can we design a system of society, with this 100-150 families living together, 1,000 people living together, identifying their basic need for happiness and prosperity and its continuity at the individual level, identifying their common goal, human goal at the level of society, and fulfilling those human goal at both at the individual and the collective level through these systems, these human systems in the human society. Right? So proper system of production, system of healthcare, system of education, and all that. So step 5 is important. We have not been able to do anything very significant at that level, but we are preparing ourselves to do that, and it is very much necessary. Wherever some efforts have been made, the results are quite encouraging, but then more condensed, an intensive effort has to be made. And then we can go on, starting with a small village community or, with a community of around 1,000 people, 150 families. Then we can scale up, to larger and larger, scale of the society. And ultimately we are saying that at some point of time, that is step N, we'll be able to develop this model for human society, for, holistic living at the level of world community. So presently we are able to work or thinking of working at the level of, community, small community of 1,000 people, of 150 families. But then ultimately we have to think and work for the, living model of the human society at the level of world community. So these are the steps, broad steps for transition, starting from step 1 to step 4. Many of us are already working. Now it is time that we start working for step 5. But ultimately, we have to work for step N. So I have put N instead of putting particular number like 10 or 15 or 20, because I want to keep it open, that we have to start with this community, small community level, okay, with 1,000 people, 100 families, 150 families, like that. But then we have to build up, and go right up to the world family. Because if we stop anywhere in between, we'll be in trouble. So even if there is one community, one nation, who is not having this right understanding and right feeling and right thought, who does not have this human, consciousness, then they will be problem for themselves and they will keep creating problem for others. And we have enough examples of that. So what we will do is describe some of these steps in brief, right? Because now that we have gone through all these 27 lectures, we have already talked about this harmony at different levels, and we have also talked about how we can go about understanding them and how we can go about ensuring the right kind of feeling and thought and how we can live with that harmony. So I will just recall, some of these things under these different steps. So step 1 is the step for individual transformation. And if you remember, we have been talking about this again and again, that when we want to work for this individual transformation from animal consciousness to human consciousness, these three sub-steps are important. So 1.1 is to verify the proposals on your own, right? That is on the basis of your natural acceptance and on the basis of your experiential validation. So this is something which we have been talking about, right? This self-exploration, right from the beginning of this course. Right? We have been saying that the process of, you know, transformation is the process of, is through the process of self-exploration. And with this self-exploration, we'll be able to understand the harmony, the relationship, the coexistence, right? And also, you know, start working with it, okay, in terms of living in accordance with that. The second point, the second step, that is 1.2, is to be aware of yourself, of your imagination, that is desire, thought, and expectation every moment. With this awareness, you will know the content of your imagination and also of all the accumulated acceptances which you are having, you know, and that is what is called your sanskar. So I have to be aware of my imagination every moment. I have to be aware of my desire, thought, and expectation every moment. So I have to be aware of my sanskar every moment. This is important because all the problem that I'm facing is sitting there in my sanskar, sitting there in my imagination, my desire, thought, and expectation. So at least I have to be aware of it. I have to be aware of it every moment, because this desire, thought, and expectation, this imagination is going on every moment. Right? Whether we are aware of it or we are not aware of it, it is going on. So I have to be aware of it every moment. So this is the second sub-step. Now, with this awareness of your imagination, of your sanskar, the third sub-step is self-evaluation. To evaluate your sanskar vis-a-vis your natural acceptance and making it in line with your natural acceptance. So when I'm looking at this imagination, this sanskar that is there in me at this moment of time, okay, I'm being self-aware. And now I'm evaluating it on the basis of my natural acceptance. So I'm doing this self-evaluation. This is what we are calling a self-evaluation. So in step two, I was aware of my imagination. In step three, I'm now asking myself whether this desire that I have, this feeling that I have at this moment, is it naturally acceptable to me or is it not naturally acceptable to me? So I'm doing this self-evaluation. And then if I am able to make sure that my feeling at this moment, my desire at this moment is in line with my natural acceptance, then I can ensure being in a state of harmony and happiness within. So that is self-evolution. So I'm evolving myself to a higher stage of being, where I am able to ensure that my feeling is in line with my natural acceptance. And therefore, I'm in a state of harmony and happiness. So I'm living with human consciousness at this moment of time. Right. So these are the three sub-steps. And of course, you can recall, you know, that we have been talked about that sanskar can be updated every moment through the process of having right kind of environment and right kind of, you know, self-exploration. So the sanskar at this point of time and the environment at this point of time plus my self-exploration at this point of time will lead to the sanskar at the next moment. So this is how we can update. So through these sub-steps, 1, 2, and 3, through the self-exploration, self-awareness, and self-evaluation, right, leading to self-evolution, we can, you know, undergo this individual transformation. Transformation from animal consciousness to human consciousness. Right? And this we will discuss. Yeah, go back, Rajulji, to the last previous slide. Yeah, so this is discussed quite in detail in the course UHV3. So we have this course as an open elective, understanding human being, nature, and existence comprehensively. So this is a course which is open, offered as an elective, you know, open elective, at least in UP Technical University. You know. And there we are talking about this transformation, this individual transformation, quite in detail. In fact, 14 practice sessions out of the 42, you know, sessions in that course is devoted basically to this transformation, you know, individual transformation. So we can look at those details there. But even in this course, we have been talking about this transformation through this self-awareness, you know, and self-evaluation. Yes. In step two, we have to create mass awareness towards holistic development and the human education. So with the right understanding and right feeling in you, you will develop the willingness and capacity to share it with others. And this is what we were discussing, right, when we were responding to the question from Minu Mehtaji. We were saying that, yes, if we have this right understanding, or if we are developing this right understanding and the right feeling, it will be a very natural process for us to share this with others. So you will develop the willingness and the capacity to share it with others. Through sharing, you are facilitating and developing other people to have right understanding, right feeling, and right thought. And this is important to note, that you can facilitate others, you cannot make others understand. They have to understand themselves. You can facilitate, I can facilitate, right? But ultimately, each one has to understand himself, right? So through sharing, you are facilitating and developing other people to have the right understanding, right feeling, and right thought. So I can facilitate the other. Okay, when I have this understanding, when I'm working for this right understanding, right feeling, and right thought, I can also facilitate the other, you know, to go through this process of self-exploration, you know, and understand things for himself or herself. This sharing can be in the form of informal discussion or in the form of formal workshops. So different types of workshops can be thought of where, you know, we can help people to get the initial idea, you know, about it, initial proposals about it, so that they can start working on themselves. Then the people to share with would include, among others. So we would like to share with everyone, but, you know, our focus is, you know, with the family members and friends, with the people who have interest and readiness for purposeful social effort and societal development. So these are the people to begin with whom we can think of working. Then if we want to work for bringing it into the mainstream education, then yes, we have to work with the teachers, the educators, the education administrators, you know, the policy makers, and the parents. Right. So these are the, you know, stakeholders in the process of education. So we have to, you know, work with them or help them to get this basic idea. And of course, we have to work with the policymakers, as we mentioned, you know, people who are connected to governance. So people who are deciding the policy and who are trying to execute the policy, right? They have to be kind of, you know, made aware of this. And of course, your colleagues at work, the people with whom you are working, you know, in the office, in the institution. So to begin with, these are the people with whom we can think of working. Can think of working. And a footnote is that to start with, it is important to share with those who are already willing to listen, rather than starting with people who, you know, are beginning with opposition. Right? So it is better to start this sharing once you have done sufficient work on yourself, only then when, yeah. So first thing is that start with the people who are already looking for such possibilities, you know, are willing to listen. Second thing is that it is better that we work on ourselves first and come to a certain level where people are able to see that, yes, you know, there is some important significant change in you. People are able to see that, yes, your behavior is becoming more human. You are able to work with, you know, kind of better care for your environment. Then people are willing to take help from you. People are willing to take inspiration from you. Then it becomes much easier for you to work for other people. Otherwise, you know, if you have not worked on yourself and if there is no significant change in you, you know, which people can see and appreciate, then when you go about working on facilitating others, there is a likelihood that people, the other people might get in opposition. So it is better to start this sharing once you have done sufficient work on yourself. Only then people will be able to accept you as a living example and take inspiration from you. So this is the second step. And I think most of us have started this second step already. So we have to work on ourselves and we have to take care that we don't try to enforce it on the other. Right? We are only facilitating. Okay. And what we are understanding, we are, you know, trying to work on it and live according to it. That will be a real help for the other also. Then step three is moving towards human education, towards humanizing this mainstream education. And this is where we are. So first step is integrating appropriate inputs of value education at various levels in the current curricula from school education to higher education. So this is what needs to be done. Of course, we have been able to work on higher education, particularly in the professional education, the technological education. For school education, yes, we still need to do a lot of work. Okay. Some work has been done, but you know, more systematic way has to be developed so that we can work for the school education, starting from zero to, you know, primary and pre-primary, primary and secondary and higher education. We have been able to make some, you know, kind of impact at the level of professional education. So, for example, today AICT is able to accept this as one of the essential course for all the professional colleges in India coming under AICT, almost 10,000 of them. So this is first step, integrating appropriate inputs of value education at various level in the current curricula from school education to higher education. Step two is to effectively proliferate the above effort. And when we are proliferating this, the requisite support and policy initiatives, okay, are necessary. And this can be ensured by working with the agencies such as AICT, MHRD, UGC, ICMR, University Academic Councils, and School Education Boards. So working with them, you know, to get the requisite support and policy initiative is very important. And as I was mentioning that, you know, the AICT today is, you know, has seen the required, felt the importance of it, and they are able to provide the, you know, requisite support, and they are also willing to make the policy initiatives to make sure that, you know, it is there as a mainstream education. So as was mentioned that now, you know, there, this value education is a part of, you know, the SIP students induction program with 15 sessions in the very first year when they come to the college starts with the SIP, the Students Induction Program. And this Well Education, UHB, is a part of it, you know. And some 15 sessions of an hour and a half is devoted for this purpose for every student entering into the college. And then in second year, there is an essential course, right? A full 3-credit course for all the students in all the professional institution. So this is the second step or sub-step for step three. The third sub-step is it will be essential to introduce teacher orientation programs, the faculty development programs, and development of resource material to implement the above suggestions at a large scale. So this is very important thing that we have to prepare the teachers. So we have to have the faculty development program and we have to prepare the relevant material so that it can be implemented at a large scale. So if you remember, you know, we have mentioned this, that when it was experimented in IIIT Hyderabad in one college with 180 students, right, we could do with very little, you know, material or some class notes that we developed. But when it came to AKTU, UP Technical University, in 2009, there was a need for the teacher manual, for the textbook, and, you know, an extensive process of faculty development program. So that is what was worked out. You know, this book on UHB, Universal Human Values and Professional Ethics, came up in 2009 because there was a need to implement it in this university with 550 colleges. So that is very necessary to develop the relevant material and also the teachers, you know, orientation program, the faculty development program. So systematic kind of process of FDPs have been introduced, right? So we have the basic foundation kind of orientation program, and then we have refreshers, refresher one and refresher two, where we introduce the teachers to higher and higher, you know, concepts and deeper concepts. So all these courses, this I was talking about UHB 3 and UHB 4, have developed out of those, you know, higher levels of faculty development program. And the fourth step is to provide adequate trust for R&D dedicated towards transforming the whole mainstream education into humanistic education, the value-based education. This is going to be a long-term, you know, long-drawn process. However, it is indispensable. So this is important that once we, you know, are able to introduce this as a part of the mainstream education and we have the proper material developed for it in the, you know, faculty development programs, right? We need to work for, you know, kind of work with a thrust on research and development, which are dedicated towards transforming this whole mainstream education, you know, into humanistic education. And also, of course, from inhuman society to human society. So a lot of work has to be done. How this education today can be made, you know, a human education or humanistic education, how it can be made value-based education. So a lot of work has to be done because as we have been discussing, when you have this basic understanding of this human consciousness, the human values, the human conduct, then you feel the need that whatever is being taught today in the name of science or in the name of technology or in the name of, you know, arts, all that has to be guided by this understanding of this, you know, harmony, this coexistence, understanding of this human value, the human conduct. So we have to develop all these objects under the guidance of this, you know, human values. So a lot of research work has to be done. So So it will take time, but it has to be started. And it was started, as we were mentioning at one point of time, that, you know, 1980s, you know, few people in IIT Delhi, you know, and one of them being Professor Arul Gaur, they started working on this. They felt the need that you have to, you know, bring in this humanity in our education. So they started working on it, and they came up with this course on science and humanism. One course, you know, offered as an open elective to those who were willing. So something like 40, 50 students used to register for that course. Starting from there, now we have this as part of this essential curriculum from AICT, which is covering something like 15 lakhs students. So that's how things have grown. But then enough work has been done in terms of trying to work out how this can be, you know, made available to every child, every student. So this R&D is very much required. This R&D about how this mainstream education can be transformed into humanistic education. A lot of work has to be done on it. And most of us who are already in teaching can significantly contribute to it. Yeah, in fact, whatever has been done till now in this value education or value-based education is done by mostly by the teachers who are already there in place teaching one of the institutions. So that way, all of us can contribute very significantly. And I was just mentioning last session when we were talking about professional ethics, that in the light of this understanding of universal human values, now we have to work out how this ethics would look like and how the professional ethics would look like in each and every area. So we have given some broad principles and guidelines about professional ethics, but then much more detail has to be worked out. You know, specific detail has to be worked out, you know, regarding this professional ethics in different areas, in the area of science, in the area of technology, even in the area of technology, in the area of mechanical engineering and civil engineering and other things. All that work has to be done by all of us. Yes. Now, with this, you know, in place, so once we have this institution with value education, you know, becoming a part of it, and then working for value-based education, then the fourth step is developing educational institutions as models for holistic living. So it is important to develop educational institutions as living models for holistic development for human society. Right. So if you want to work for human society, we have to start with these educational institutions and develop them as a living model for holistic development, living model for human society. So this will also necessitate linking the educational institution with local development programs in collaboration with voluntary organizations and government agencies. Right. So now this institution is not just working for, you know, giving education, you know, but it is concerned with ensuring that it is a living model of a human society. And for doing this, it will have to, you know, interact with the people around, with the community around, right? And then the focus of R&D in higher education institutions will need to be shifted towards various aspects of holistic development, resulting in the development of real life models facilitating universal human order. So we have to do a lot of R&D work in this institution so that, you know, they work out how they can be self-sustaining society or self-sustaining institution, okay, which is an example of the human society. Okay. And also on how they can contribute, you know, to the community around. Right? And that is the next step. But in this step, we have to do a lot of R&D in the institution so that we exactly work out the process of how we can live as a human, as a human society. Right? So what are the things and how they can be realized? Right? So what kind of system of production we should have within the institution, what kind of education we should have, and what kind of healthcare we should have, and all those details can be worked out by the institution. And once they are able to do this for their own institution, make it a living model, then they can work for the next step, that is step five, which is, can we move to the next? Yes. So we can move to this step five. If we have developed ourselves, or if we are developing ourselves as a living model, of this society as an institution, then we can work for developing models for human society, at least holistic living at the level of community. So this we have discussed in the last session, that how this model for holistic living in the community, at the level of these people, around 1,000 people living together, 100-150 families living together, how this can be ensured. So we have already discussed this in the last session, not in too much of detail, but yes, some details have been provided on which we have to work further. So we need to develop the model for human society at different levels. We have to start with the community at the village level, for example, with around 1,000 people and around 100-150 families. And this, the institution can choose, to work around, the community around it. And that will be a good, beginning. But ultimately we have to go up to developing the model for the world family level. So we have to start with the immediate community of this size, a small community. But this size is important, because all the functions of production and education and healthcare can be ensured within this size. If we have very small community, then probably different functions which have to be performed will not be possible. So this is an appreciable size, 1,000 people, 100-150 families. The kind of professions, for example, if you try to identify, at least if you look at the Indian villages, it was identified that there are around 36 types of profession which are required, because there are around these 36 types of functions which have to be carried out, like agriculture, and then pottery and blacksmith and all those things. Around 36 of them are required. So at least we need 36 families. But then you need more than one family for many of these professions. So altogether it comes to something like 100-150 families. So, but all these details can be worked out, just giving a hint. So ultimately, this step five has to be extended up to the level of world community. And that is what we are saying, step N. So step N is developing models for human society, holistic living at the level of world community. So this is where we have to reach ultimately. But to do this, we have to start with a community of this small size, 1,000 people, 150 families. Right? And to do this, we have to first develop these educational institutions as a living model, right? As a resource center for this, this self-sufficient community, this holistic, living, or community with holistic living. So this is how we can go about it, starting from step one, that is individual transformation, then working for step two, then three, then four. And while working with step four, we are developing our institution as a living model. Then we can start thinking in terms of working with the community around. So working with step five, and ultimately we have to start working for step N, right? At least we can do enough research, development work, and the extension work as and when the situation is favorable. So this is in essence what is going to be the process of transition. This is what is going to be the process of transition. So this is what we have to keep in mind. You know, this is what is the brief description of the steps of a transition towards a human society, towards value-based living and value-based profession. So this is what we wanted to propose, but what we will do is that, you know, talk about some of the details about the step 3, 4, and 5. Okay. Particularly the step 3 and 4, which is going to be there in the educational institution, you know, and where we all have to work, because step 1 and 2, we are already into it. Step 3 and 4, you know, we can look into some details and something which has already been done, you know. So if we have that clarity with us, then probably we can work on this step 3 and step 4 in particular. Okay. So this is what we have placed here. I'm not going to discuss in detail, but I'll draw your attention and you can reflect on it, you know, as and when you have time. You know, this PPT will be available to you. So if you remember, step 3 is moving towards human education, towards humanizing the mainstream education. And step 4 is developing models. Can we go back, Rajiv? Back, please.
Sorry.
Next. Mm-hmm. Further. Go forward. Yes. Back. One slide back. Yes. So step 3 is moving towards human education, and step 4 is developing models for holistic living in educational institution. So this is where we can work, you know. Most of us who are teaching somewhere in one of the you know, institutions, the educational institution. So that is where we can work, step 3 and step 4. So steps in implementing human education at the level of institution, at the level of university. So let's look at some of the details. Yes. So these are the 3 key steps which I have already mentioned, right? Step 1 is value education. Step 2 is value-based education, and step 3 is value-based living. So incorporating values in existing curriculum, incorporating case studies of harmonious living, cases from local culture, civilization, knowledge systems, and so on. And we have a lot of examples from the Indian knowledge system, which has developed over thousands of years with this, you know, human values at the base. So we'll have a lot of case studies from there. And then incorporating practice, you know, practice in skill development. So we have to have this value education, and then we have to have the skill education, right, in the first step. In the second step, we have to make sure that, you know, the whole curriculum is on the basis of values, on the basis of living in harmony. And then holistic and value-based, you know, and practice-oriented education is given. So holistic and value-based and practice-oriented and integrative skill development is ensured. So the whole curriculum is value-based, and all our practice and skill development is value-based. And of course, the third step is ensuring this value-based living. So practice of living in harmony, harmonious behavior, work, and participation in the family, in the institution, society, and so on. So these are the broad steps, you know, if we have to work on step 3 and 4 that we have mentioned, you know, the sub-steps which will be required is this: value education, value-based education, and value-based living. And if you spread this, you know, then this is how it would look like. Next, Rajiv, can we move to the next slide? So these sub-steps, 3 sub-steps that we have just mentioned, can be spread over larger number of steps, you know. So these are the steps which we have been working on already in the educational institution over the last 20 years. So we can just kind of mention them. Step 1 is to introduce or strengthen right understanding in the academic curriculum of the university, of the institute, along with existing courses. So we have worked out these different courses. We have this foundation course on universal human values and professional ethics. Then we have higher level courses, which I've just mentioned, like UHV 3 and 4. Then we have elective courses. You know, many other courses have been designed, which I will mention some other time. You know, so we have now developed many courses based on different kind of philosophy that are in kind of prevalence. Then we have to develop the social projects, the socially relevant final year projects, and so on. And of course, the social internship. Right? So while they are going through the process of education, there can be this social internship where they can connect to the society, you know, to the community around. And of course, this weekly meeting and, you know, reaching to all faculty, staff, students, and community. So this is the first step. And there is enough work being done on this step one, at least in professional education, in engineering education in particular. But same thing can be done in higher education in general, and it can be done in school education. So once this base work is done, then the step two is establish a stream of value-based education at the university. So we can have UG and PG diploma and degree programs in value-based skills based on holistic development with well-being of all in the center. So we can have these programs in technology, management, social sciences, economics and finance, political sciences, etc. And this IKG, Punjab Technical University, has offered, you know, at one time it has tried sincerely on 1 year PG diploma in universal human values and professional ethics, and 2 year MTech in holistic development systems and technologies. So many of the institution now are thinking in terms of offering such, you know, courses which are value-based. And step three is, as we mentioned, you know, value-based living at the institution. So value-based living, living on the basis of right understanding. And this can be seen in two steps. In step three, we can start with handling this issue of education, issue of mutually fulfilling behavior, and issue of health. So this is what we can handle, you know, in the third step. With whatever other structure going on, you know, at the level of physical thing, okay, whatever is going on, we can let it go, but we can start working on, you know, the kind of education that we are giving. So it has to be value plus skill. Then we can work on our behavior. Can we can work on our health. The second, the fourth step would be that while we are working with this step three on education, behavior, and health, we can also work with rest of nature, right, to ensure this preservation as well as self-sufficiency. So self-sufficiency of the institution through cyclic and mutually enriching production activities, you know, can be started. And we can take these activities to a scale where the needs of all the faculty, staff, and students are fulfilled within. So we are able to ensure this mutual prosperity in human rest of nature relationship. Of course, this is a very difficult thing to do to begin with, because most of our education is not, you know, production oriented. Okay, we are not related to the rest of nature around us. So this will be a little difficult step to move, but at least we should have this in mind and we can start working on it. Then of course, this once we have such institutions which are working, you know, at the level of their education and at the level of their behavior, you know, relationship and so on, then we can think in terms of developing them as nodal centers, right? Nodal centers for the community around, so that they can share and promote value education and value-based education, either the other institutions and in the community, share and promote value-based living also, right? So we already have, you know, many institutions in technological, in UPTU, the UP Technical University, and in Bikaner Technical University and some of the colleges in Punjab Technical University, which are essentially trying to do this work, you know. They are working as a nodal center to ensure this well education and value-based education in other institutions and also in the nearby community. Yes. And once we have these nodal centers, you know, working, they can develop further themselves to work as a regional nodal center and national resource center and ultimately the global resource center. So as we said that, you know, we begin with the institution, but then we work for the community around, you know, and then larger and larger community. And ultimately, you know, we become a resource center for, you know, working for the world family, right? Working for this undivided society and universal human order. So these are the different steps, you know, eight steps have been mentioned here. But as I said, that these are, you know, kind of one way of describing this process of transition, you know, at the level of academic institution. But there can be, you know, other ways of describing this. But it is useful in the sense that this is something which have been done up to this step five, this nodal center, a lot of things have been done, okay? And other than 6-7 step can be, you know, worked further. So even now we have regional resource centers in UP Technical University, many of them. So all these are practical things which have been done. But then there can be different ways of going about it. But this seems to be a sound way of going about, you know, and it has been successful. Yes, so this is what we can do at the level of academic institutions, at the level of educational institution. And just one mention of this, that if you remember those steps that we had talked about, the steps for transition, the 3 and 4 we have discussed, step 5 is about developing models for human society, that is holistic living in the community. So out of this, we had worked out, you know, some detail in the last session about a holistic community model. So it has been already discussed in brief in the last session, but it will be discussed in detail. Rajulji, back, can we go back? Yes. It will be discussed in detail in the course, you know, on UHB 4, which is a course on vision for a human society. So we have a course on vision for a human society, this UHB 4 it is called, right? There we are discussing quite in detail about this, you know, developing models for human society. What will be our behavior and what will be our conduct in a human society? That we have tried to discuss quite in detail in this course on vision for a human society. So this is the essence of what, we wanted to place in this session. So with this, I will just sum up. Yes. Next, Rajulji. Yeah, so the key takeaways is that to ensure happiness and prosperity and their continuity for all human beings, the transition to human consciousness and human society is essential. So this is what we said in the first session, and this is what we have to say in the last session. That ultimately, we all as human beings want to ensure happiness and prosperity and its continuity, you know, for all human beings. And to do this, we have to transit, or we have to transform from animal consciousness to human consciousness and from inhuman society to human society. And that this requires a dedicated effort to implement at a mass scale the humanistic education focusing on right understanding. So this transformation, individual and societal transformation, can take place through human education, through education which is based on right understanding, right feeling, right thought, and right behavior, work, and participation in the larger order. So human education or humanistic education can be the agent for this transformation from animal consciousness to human consciousness, from inhuman society to human society, which is very essential for ensuring the fulfillment of every human being in terms of living with continuity of happiness and prosperity. So this is the essence of what we have been saying, you know, in this session and what we have been saying all through this course. So with that, I will stop my discussion on this session and also in the whole course on UHP, Human Values and Professional Ethics. So with that,